Good evening and welcome to the October 9th, 2014 regular session of the Xenia City Council. We've been in session since 6 p.m. this evening talking about our 2015 to 2019 five-year capital improvement program. Now we're ready to begin the regular session. I'd ask you to stand and join with me in the invocation led by the mayor this evening, followed by the pledge delivered by Vice President Long.
Let's pray. Dear Lord, we thank you for another day. Lord, we thank you for those who are gathered here. Lord, right now we ask your special blessings on this meeting tonight, Lord, and all of the council members that are gathered here, and all of our city employees as well, Lord. Lord, even now we come to you and ask that you just be with the families and the staff and students at Central Middle School, Lord, and our superintendent as well. We just pray a special blessing on them right now. Lord, we're thankful for them being together and the love that they have for one another and the great support that they're getting from the city and from businesses and everywhere around, Lord. Lord, we just count on you, Lord, to just continue to touch and to continue to bless each and every one of us. These blessings we ask in your precious name. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Thank you very much, Mayor and Vice President Long. May I have roll call, please?
Vice President Long.
Here.
Councilman Cowell.
Here.
Councilman Lauterbach.
Here.
Councilman Smith.
Here.
Woman Mills.
Here.
Mayor Bayless.
Here.
President Engel.
Here. May I have a motion, please, for approval of minutes from the September 25th, 2014 executive and regular session, please?
So moved, Mr. President.
Moved by Councilman Lauterbach. Second, please.
Second.
Second by Councilman Kalp. Any discussion or question on the minutes before us, please? Seeing none, roll call.
Vice President Long.
Aye.
Councilman Kalp.
Aye.
Councilman Lauterbach.
Aye.
Councilman Smith.
Aye.
Councilwoman Mills.
Aye.
Mayor Bayless.
Abstain.
President Engel.
Aye.
Motion carried.
Thank you. Now we have the opportunity for a special presentation this evening on electrical aggregation update. If you would take the podium, ma'am. Thank you.
Thank you. Good evening. I'm Brenda Fargo with Strategic Aggregation Consultants. You folks hired me to assist you through the aggregation process, and we're about to start that. So that's why I'm here. We wanted to take an opportunity to inform you folks, as well as those that would be watching the cable broadcast, about what's going on, what to expect, and when the mailers are coming, and all of that kind of intricate stuff that we want them to have as much information about as possible so that they can make an informed decision and feel good about the program that they have. So we'll jump right into it. First slide. I guess I can look over there and see what's up there. So. What is the Xenia Aggregation Program? Just as a little bit of background, back in 2001 is when the state of Ohio brought about deregulation. And what that means is individuals can choose an alternate generation supplier for their electricity at their home, and communities, such as the city of Xenia, can institute opt-out aggregation programs to provide a program for their residents. In November of 2013, the voters of Xenia decided that they wanted to approve that opportunity. So the city of Xenia was given the opportunity and given the authority by voters to implement an opt-out aggregation program. We've been working on that for the last few months. We put out bids and we received four different bids from suppliers. We ultimately selected First Energy Solutions to be the provider for the program for the next 2 years. And I'll get into what the details of that program are going to be. The first thing I want to talk about, though, is what an opt-out program is. An opt-out program means that everybody is in the program unless they choose to opt out. So it's a little different than what you're used to. You're automatically in unless you send in a form to get out, and that's very important that you understand that. You're going to start receiving information in the mail. They were actually mailed this week, and they may hit as soon as tomorrow, probably start hitting Saturday and Monday is when you'll start seeing them in your mailbox. All of the eligible customers will receive an opt-out mailing. This is what it will look like. It's not very exciting, It's got some legalese in it because there are some things that are absolutely required by law that be contained within the opt-out notification. But this is what you will receive in your mailbox, and you would need to take a look at this. It will only go, and this is very, very important, it will only go to eligible accounts. What are eligible accounts? Okay. Those that are not eligible are those that are on the PIP program, which is the Percent of Income Plan Payment Program. That's a program that assists folks with payment of their utility bills if they're having difficulty meeting those bills. They, by law, are not allowed to be included in any opt-out aggregation program. So if you on the cable broadcast are watching and you're on PIP, you will not receive a letter. So don't be concerned. It's simply because you're not eligible. So that's one group. Another very important group is if you have already selected a supplier for your home, you're already under contract with another supplier, you will not receive a letter from the city. You will only continue with your selected supplier, and at what time you decide to end that contract, you can join the city's program, but you will not be solicited by the city to join the program. So you're going to remain on your own until you choose to do otherwise. Throughout the entire span of the program, if you want to get into the program, you can at the same rate as everybody else. You simply would wait till the end of your contract with whatever supplier you have and then enroll at that time in the program. Others that will not receive it are commercial customers that use more than 700,000 kilowatt hours annually. So large commercial and industrial customers will not receive a letter. They will not be included in the opt-out program. And neither will what's called mercantile accounts. Those folks are the national accounts, Burger King, Wendy's, Subways, you know, those types of things that are of a national nature. Those typically have their bills and their decisions made on a more national level, and they are not, by law, allowed to be included in local governmental aggregations. So they will not receive a letter as well. So if you're in one of those categories and you don't receive a letter, that's why. You're not eligible for the program. If you are not in any of those categories and you do not receive a letter for some reason, you need to call into the call center and find out why. You may not have been on the list from the utility that was provided, and we'll need to check that out and make sure that we get you the opt-out notification. We did go through the list, and it looked very good. It looked like we've covered the entire geographic area of the city. So I'm very confident that we've covered everybody, but there are occasionally instances where someone is missed because of timing issues. If their contract had ended with their current supplier and they didn't make it on the eligibility list in time. So there's some types of things that could be reasons why you didn't get a letter. Opt-out letters, like I said, will be delivered, if not tomorrow, then very soon thereafter. You will have 21 days to respond to the letter. The opt-out deadline is October 29th. Which means that your opt-out must be postmarked by the 29th. What we do, and we've asked First Energy Solutions to provide a 5-day grace period, because what that means is if you postmark it, they have to wait for, obviously, the mail to get there. So they do that so that they can make sure that they get all the opt-outs in before they start the process. Program details. As I said before, the supplier is First Energy Solutions. It is a 2-year term. And the term or the opportunity for savings is a 15% discount off of your Dayton Power and Light power price to compare. On your bill, you're going to have what's called your price to compare. That is the number that you have to be below by a supplier in order to save. So that's kind of your check as to whether you're going to save money or not. Well, this program is a guaranteed discount of 15% off of that. So there's really no guesswork. You're guaranteed to save. It's just a matter of what other program you might be enrolled in. You have to take a look at that and decide whether you want to then enroll in the city's program at whatever point. So as an example, I just put here, excuse the glasses, if your PTC, and everyone is likely to have a different PTC, so you'll need to look at your own bill to kind of do this calculation. If your PTC is the 7.8 cents per kilowatt hour, you would take 15% off of that, giving you a final of 6.63 cents per kilowatt hour. If you use 750 kilowatt hours a month, and that's kind of a typical residential household. So if you use that, we're estimating the savings to be approximately $105 a year. So some are going to save more, some are going to save less. It just really depends upon your usage level and what your PTC is. But that gives you kind of an understanding, a little bit of what your savings might be. So, and the details, there's some additional details in the opt-out letter as to some of those types of information. Another very important part of this is that there is no cancellation fee, and we talked about this when we first brought the offer to you. Making sure there's no cancellation fee is very important, because if in a year there's a great opportunity and someone comes in with a great price, you want your folks to be able to take that opportunity. So what they can do is they can leave the program at any time. They can also enter the program at any time. So as I said, if there's a gentleman with a contract, I talked to someone last week who was on a contract, and he's going to wait until his contract expires at the end of November and then enroll in the program. So those folks are eligible to come into the program at any time. So if you are currently with another supplier and want to join, you can do that. If you do, this is another very important element. Once the 21 days is over, and October 29th comes, and we have the five-day grace period, and we're beginning of November, what's going to happen is First Energy Solutions will send that entire enrollment file to Dayton Power and Light. Dayton Power and Light, by law, within 24 hours of receiving that file, must send a letter to every potential participant telling them you're about to be enrolled in this program. And if it isn't what you wanted, you get an opportunity of 7 days to say, okay, I want out. So it's essentially a second opt-out, but if you didn't opt out the first time and you want to stay in the program, you simply disregard the letter. It's just, by law, the utility has to notify you that they're about to switch you. We always get a lot of phone calls around that time with people saying, well, I don't know what this is. So we really want you to understand that that is simply a letter that's required by the utility, and if you want to stay in the program, don't do anything with it. Just disregard the letter completely. Questions. We ask that you don't call the city. That sounds a little weird because it's the city's program. I understand that. But our supplier has a very well-trained, highly staffed call center who can handle your very complex questions. I'm actually going to be spending an hour or so tomorrow with some of the city staff, walking them through the program, making sure they understand the opt-out materials, making sure they understand the frequently asked questions. But they're not the experts. They're here to do the work of the city. They're not here to take phone calls for the aggregation program. So we really ask that if you have questions, that you call First Energy Solutions, and that is listed on your opt-out materials. The phone number will be there numerous times so that you can find that. Also included, there is a list of frequently asked questions that are going to be mailed with your opt-out materials. Please read those, because those are frequently asked questions. It's typical that you will have the same questions as everybody else, and hopefully your question will be contained within that. If it's not, then feel free to contact First Energy Solutions, and they will assist you with whatever questions you might have. Again, please try not to call the city. This is absolutely a city program, and the city is behind it. However, we want you to call the folks that are really equipped to be able to handle these technical calls. That's essentially it. I would love to answer any questions that council might have.
Yeah, I brought my bill with me. I've been a DP&L customer for 50 years.
Mm-hmm.
Does that mean, am I under contract with DP? Will I be getting an opt-out letter?
Can I see your bill?
Sure.
I'll be able to tell you. What happens when you're with another supplier is that you will get a second section. You will get a section that talks about your supplier. No, you are not with a supplier. You're currently with Dayton Power and Light as a straight utility customer. So you will get a letter.
Okay. And on here it says DP&L's price of 8.9 cents per kilowatt hour. It says I can save. Is DP&L's 8.9? I've heard that kind of fluctuates. Is DP&L's 8.9? Is that what I'm paying 8.9 cents per?
That's your price to compare. That's your generation portion. Your generation portion is approximately one half of your bill. The other half remains with DP&L for meter reading, storm outages, all of those types of maintenance things. They get the other half of the bill, and you can't get an alternate supplier for that. So that 8.9, that's your current PTC. So what you would do is go through the calculation of how many kilowatt hours you use minus 15% off of the PTC, and that would tell you what you would save.
Yeah, it's very confusing to the public. It's confusing to me.
I'm
no rocket scientist, but it's confusing to me.
Yes.
But I think we need, are we going to have this on the website? And
definitely. And there's information on the website. Again, you know, as Brenda said, we'd rather people call First Energy, but we are providing some training. So,
right.
You know, if they do happen to call us, that we can certainly try to help. And if not, provide information to First Energy. But
yeah,
it is confusing.
What's confusing, DP&L, my good friend Eric's in the audience, DP&L is the transmission supplier, right?
That's correct. And
people
local utility.
DP&L is still going to be the transmission, no?
Absolutely. Absolutely.
Oh, yes, okay. I thought you said no. So
nothing changes with who brings the electricity into your home. If there's an outage, you still call DP&L. DP&L still provides all the billing. Nothing changes. The only thing that will happen is your bill will have a new section on it that will say your supplier is, and in this case, First Energy Solutions, and their charges are X. That's the only thing that changes.
Okay. Thank you.
But there may be some customers that are actually with DPL Energy that will not get a letter.
That is correct.
Because that's a secondary supplier, correct?
That is correct.
That gets confused.
And they would have, if you look on your bill,
I'm with DPL Energy.
If you look on your bill, there will be a separate section that will talk about who your supplier is. That's how, if you forgot that you did something, you know, a year ago or so, look at your bill, and if it has that new section in it, that will tell you that you're with a supplier.
Anytime we can save the citizens 15%, we're all for that.
Absolutely.
And I think our next step should be natural gas, but that's another story. But
we wanted to do the electric first because there's more opportunity for savings there. So we wanted to get the bigger nut, you know, before we moved on to the other.
Thank you.
Yeah. Vice President.
So currently right now, members of the same community getting power straight from DP&L, like Councilman Latimer, they can have different PTCs?
Yes. Yes.
So I'm confused on why First Energy is just not, as an aggregate, why are we just not offering our community that same rate? My neighbor could be getting 50% off his, but mine could be a little higher, and I get 50% off. We're switching to the city's plan. We have two different rates.
Well, and you already do.
I know that.
Yeah.
I thought the aggregate would help bring some normalcy to it.
Well, remember what we talked about is we didn't want to go with a fixed price because there's such uncertainty as to what's going to happen to the PTC with the auction schedules.
I do remember that now.
So we felt that having the guaranteed discount of 15%, everyone is guaranteed to save. So that's a great position to be in, that no matter what happens, everyone's going to save.
And as things flesh out over the next couple of years here, we're in a position then to rebid this and take maybe a different approach at that point if it makes sense financially.
Right.
What about like Xenia Community Schools? Will they save on this program?
Schools probably are on their own. Okay. The School Board Association across the state has a buying pool that they put together. Mm-hmm. So they are very likely shopped on their own. I'd be very shocked if, you know, they have any accounts. You will have some city accounts that will be included in this. Very small things if you haven't already shopped. I know some of the accounts are with Direct Energy. But traffic signals, some of those types of things that just aren't big enough for another supplier to want to work with. So some of those city accounts will be brought in. So when you get opt-outs, that's what they are.
Jeannie.
I just wanted to make sure that everyone watching, this is for Xenia residents, not township, not near Xenia, but only for people who live within the city limits. So I don't want people to be expecting to receive something in the mail and then be concerned that they don't.
Excellent, excellent point. Yes. First Energy Solutions mapped the list that we got from Dayton Power and Light. And what that means is every account that they receive gets a dot on a map, and we went over the map to make sure that everything looked right. All the places that were golf courses or parks didn't have any dots in them. So, you know, it looked good as far as we could tell. There may be, and there usually are, one or two accounts that look like they were on the boundary, and a judgment call has to be made about those. So if there's someone on the very edge of the city, they may or may not. Typically they do, because we try and err on the side of inclusion. But that's what I mean. If you're not one of those ineligible type of customers and you don't get a letter, you need to give us a call.
Thank you.
Any other questions, please? Seeing none, thank you very much, ma'am.
Thank you very much.
At this point, In our meeting, we will move to a public hearing on a zoning map amendment. Mr. City Manager, would you introduce, please?
Yes, this is actually almost sort of a follow-up to some previous action that was taken. I'm going to defer to Mr. Forstner, who can bring an update with Mr. Wilson's property and what the requested action is.
Thank you. This is for 2380 Bellbrook Avenue. It's a 19,000 square foot building, roughly, a commercial building that's vacant. And it's at the corner of Berkshire and Bellbrook. There had been previous requests to rezone it to B3. Ultimately, there was a compromise and it was rezoned to B1. The applicant is back and initially requested B3, but working with me and working with the residents of the area, decided to go a commercial PUD route instead. All this is doing is it's keeping the existing zoning as it is. The only change it's making is that it's adding self-service storage units as a permitted use. The only other change is that if there are any significant changes to the site plan, it will require approval by the Planning and Zoning Commission. And Planning and Zoning Commission unanimously approved this rezoning.
Thank you very much. At this point, I will open the public hearing on this particular zoning map amendment and ask anyone who would like to speak in favor of the amendment to step forward to the podium. Provide us your name and address. Limit your comments to 3 to 4 minutes, please.
Good evening. My name is Dan Wilson. I'm actually at 1855 Bellbrook Avenue, but here to talk about 2380 Bellbrook Avenue. It's a commercial building that has seen several uses over the years. You know, approximately 2 years ago, I purchased the building and asked for a zoning change, and you know, right now it's the B1. In general, you know, I think the office market in the Dayton area is weak right now. I mean, studies are showing about a 44% occupancy, and you know, I've asked for the climate-controlled self-storage to be included. You know, to improve the security of the property and the neighborhood, all, you know, occupants would be required to use a code for entry and exit and to control the access and operating hours. You know, on the average, self-storage on the climate control visit the facility about 3 times a year. You know, I would utilize approximately about a third of the building for the limited access climate-controlled storage. And if you look in the back of that brochure, you know, Dayton Christian Schools operated that building for a couple years, and you know, we really see a lot of offices, but in the back you'll kind of see more of a classroom connotation. And what I really would be proposing is, you know, cutting those in half, which would be a lot more marketable for the storage units. So the offices wouldn't change, you know, from that standpoint. But you know, I would appreciate your consideration in this matter. And anybody got any questions?
Just one, Dan.
Sure.
You're planning right now about 6,000 square feet for the storage unit, approximately.
You know, approximately third, you know, a little less maybe, but right around.
What would your desire be for the rest of it?
I think to still market it as office startup businesses, you know, that fit into the B1.
Yeah, I want to commend you. You've done a lot of work out there, and it really looks great. It's an added value to the community and especially to the neighborhood. So I want to commend you on that.
Thank you.
Wish you the best of luck in future rentals there. Thank you.
Thank you. Any other comments or observations or questions, please? Thank you, sir. Would anyone else care to come forward and speak for the zoning map amendment, please? Seeing none, would anyone care to come forward and speak against the zoning map amendment? Would anyone care to speak neither for nor against the zoning map amendment, please? Come forward and speak. Thank you. At this time, I'll close the public hearing and request an introduction from one of my colleagues of this ordinance.
So introduced, Mr. President.
Introduced by Councilman Lauterbach. Thank you very much. At this time, we have an opportunity for audience comments. If you would like to come and address the Xenia City Council meeting this evening, please step forward to the podium, provide us your name and address, limit your comments to, given the subject matters, 5 to 10 minutes, please.
Good evening, everyone. I'm Denny Morrison, 819 Colorado, Superintendent of Schools for Xenia Community Schools. It's hard for me to know what to say this evening. We've suffered a terrible loss this week in our Xenia Community School family. We did have a little girl just turned 12 years of age, that a student at Central Middle School that took her own life. Her death is a significant impact on our entire school community. We immediately mobilized our crisis team to respond to this tragic event that we had. We've brought in additional counselors and mental health therapists to work with our students that are grieving. We've brought in additional substitutes for our teachers who have needed some time alone or simply just wanted to talk. We're going to continue to provide ongoing support for both our students and our staff. You know, as a school district, we do care about academics, but beyond academics, we continue to be committed to the social and emotional well-being of our students. This tragic event reminds us of the need for parents to talk with their students, to talk one another, and for students to reach out to trusted friends, to teachers, to adults at times of difficulty and crisis. Thank you. Life is so precious, and so are each of our students. I'm sorry. I want to commend the Central Middle School staff for their compassion and their professionalism in helping guide our students through this difficult time. You know, as we grieve the loss of this child, we have to remember that none of us are alone. I ask that you keep this child and her family in your thoughts and in your prayers. This has been, as I said, a difficult week, but you know, I've seen some beautiful things this week. Xenia is an awesome place. It's an amazing place with amazing people. The resilience that I've seen. Everyone coming together in this time of crisis. The Xenia police, they've just been phenomenal. And so supportive and so caring. Our community leaders, our business leaders, our city officials, our pastors, our churches, everyone has come and just said, Denny, you know, what can we do to help? You know, Mayor Bayless has been in, basically, I don't think she's been home. She's been at Central Middle School the entire time. And I just want to assure everyone that we're going to continue to support our young people. Tomorrow evening at Church of the Nazarene at 6 o'clock, we are going to have a candlelight vigil for the little girl, and the pastor there is going to be delivering a message of hope. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Denny. Would anyone else care to come and speak to the Xenia City Council meeting this evening, please? Sir, go ahead.
My name is John Wickersham. I live at 209 Southwest Street. And I was in upstate New York your last meeting. I didn't make it to the council meeting on this MOTA-OWN. I've called the law office numerous times and left messages, haven't got anything back. I was in here Monday, and it was kind of a mess up. I couldn't get any answers, and actually, I'd like to know what I'm supposed to be doing next. I've been taking care of this property for about 20 years. It's a big piece of property. I keep the trash. It's dumped over the fence there at the church, and trash has been thrown out. There's all kind of rubbish there. I've been taking care of poison ivy. I've been mowing it because my grandkids would play back there. I wanted to keep it clean, the glass picked up and everything like that. And I was supposed to get a letter. I haven't got anything, and I'm just at a, you know, I don't know where I'm supposed to go from here now.
I can address that. He was leaving messages on Stephanie's old voicemail, and we were not aware that he had been leaving any messages until he came in on Monday. We were not able to locate immediately all of his things on Monday, but his things have been submitted to be on the next council agenda. Even though he's been taking care of it for 20 years, he has still not done the prerequisite for all the mow that he needed to do to qualify for the program. But I went ahead and approved it because of the fact he had been taking care of it so long. So the deeds have been prepared. The agenda item has been sent to council, and he's on the next agenda. So,
thank you, Mr. Law Director. Sir.
You'll have to wait until council approves it at their next meeting. And then after that, you'll get a letter from us stating that they've approved it. And as long as we have the recording fees and cost in, we'll go ahead and record that for you, and then you'll receive it in the mail from the recorder's office.
Thank you very much. Would anyone else care to come and address the Xenia City Council this evening, please? Seeing none, moving to reports of committees, please. Councilwoman Mills, Board for Recreation, Arts, and Cultural Activities.
Thank you. We had a few things that we discussed this evening.
Can I just say something before?
Take it, bro. Denny?
Mr. Morrison?
I just really wanted the public to know that we have one of the most caring superintendents, and we are so fortunate to have him. And, you know, God puts people where they need to be, especially for a time like this. And I know that he has had no sleep. And he's been there each day as I have, but just such a caring person. And you, when he walks in, you feel that you have his support, you know that he cares. And so I just am so thankful for him and how fortunate Xenia Schools are to have someone like him taking the lead, and especially in a situation like this. So I just thank God for you.
Thank you. Thank you, Mayor. Thank you, Denny.
BRCA had our meeting just this past week, and we are very excited to announce that the banner program has been re-submitted again. So if you would like to purchase one of the beautiful banners that we have hanging in our community, you are welcome to do so. You can find it online on the City of Xenia's website, and there is an application. We have many polls, and we encourage you, if you have a business, if a personal family wants to, you can do an honor of, in memory of, local churches, anything. So we just encourage you to look at the website if you're very interested in doing that. As a matter of fact, I'm giving mine to the mayor right now. The other thing that we're doing is we are closing our year for our beautification awards. If you take an interest in your home and your property and you stand out in your area, then we want to recognize you. Anyone can make a nomination for a beautification award, and it's a wonderful thing that this community does to honor. And the mayor hand delivers them after she signs every one of these. So, Mayor, I've signed mine.
Thank you.
My work.
My neighbor.
It is. There you go. And then lastly, one of the great things that BRCA has been working with this year is Hometown Christmas. That is coming up very quickly, and we are very excited to know that we have the string benders for entertainment at Towards Independence. Mr. Ritchie is going to do a science show at Towards Independence, and the Xenia Ensemble is going to perform at Towards Independence. And we have one other opening that we're hoping to fill really soon with a commitment. And there's going to be bingo being offered to play, and we're going to have different types of baskets that if you win bingo, you can put your name on a card and drop it in a basket for a basketball raffle. We are looking to doing a scavenger hunt, with Towards Independence being the home spot for that. We are also doing the Xenia Downtown Now silent auction, and the Woman at Risk Jewelry will be also there at Towards Independence, so we encourage you to come and participate in that. We are also going to be offering some games, some puzzles, and things of that nature that you can just stay and have a good time there. So our goal this year for Hometown Christmas at Towards Independence is it's all about the family, and we just want families to be able to come and have a good time. And that's what we have at BRCA.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Any questions for Councilwoman Mills and BRCA, please?
When's the date for Hometown Christmas?
That is the second Saturday in December, and that is December the 13th, from hours 4 o'clock to 8 o'clock p.m.
Okay. Thank you. Any other questions, please? Seeing none, Councilman Smith, Traffic Commission, please.
Thank you, Mr. President. Three items on the agenda for the October 6th Xenia Traffic Commission meeting. The first was to authorize the engineering staff to send letters to Wes Ankeny Mill Road residents regarding a proposed no parking zone on the south side of West Ankeny Mill Road between King Street and North Galloway for a distance of 84 feet from the center line on North King. That has been endorsed by the Traffic Commission unanimously, and that will be coming to City Council. The next item was just a housekeeping ordinance and on our city ordinance versus the Ohio Revised Code regarding U-turns in the city. That was presented by Sergeant Stutes. That was recommended unanimously by the Traffic Commission to come to City Council, as well as a request to establish or clarify the speed limit on Bellbrook Avenue between Allison Avenue and West 2nd Street. A lot of people don't know if it's 25 through there, 35 through there. As most of those thoroughfares enter the city, the traffic, the speed limit comes down to 25. So that was recommended by Traffic Commission unanimously to come back to City Council at a later date, and that will be voted on. I believe that will come to Council on the November 13th meeting, and that's all I have.
Thank you. Any questions for Councilman Smith? Traffic Commission, please. Seeing none, Mayor Bayless, Board of Zoning Appeals.
Thank you. I was sick for the Board of Zoning Appeals, and I know there was one item, and perhaps Mr. Forshner might speak to that.
Yes, it was approval of a determination of similar use to allow a manufactured home to be built in an R1C district.
Thank you.
Thank you.
See, that's what youth can do. You can just come up and remember everything and go right on.
Yeah. Yes, it was approved. If you have more questions, I can go into more detail, but if not, I won't.
Any questions for Board of Zoning Appeals this time, please?
Is that the one on Ormsby?
It is on Ormsby Drive. I should have mentioned that.
Any other questions, please?
See, I wasn't told.
Seeing none, thank you, Mayor Bayless, and thank you to the right-hander coming in.
Yeah.
At this time, we have items from City Council and Mayor. Do any of my colleagues have anything to bring to the good of the order, please?
Just one. I guess I could wait till summary of action items. Several times I brought up in these meetings about having students from the schools come in to say our Pledge of Allegiance. I won't rest until that happens. I think it's important for student citizenship to know the Pledge of Allegiance and even prayer, but I don't want to get into that right now. But again, I want to put this on the action items. I would like to see Xenia City Schools cooperate with the City of Xenia and do our Pledge of Allegiance. Thank you.
Thank you. Anything else, please?
I just have one. A lot of people have asked me, and I don't know the answer, but Ha Ha Pizza downtown Xenia, does anybody know where we're at with that? Or?
Yeah. I do, and I can talk a little bit to it. They are still in the process of getting things organized. Okay. I was told this week that they're having some, working through some issues relative to a hood in their facility. Okay. So they are working through that process, and they had already hoped to be open by now, so I know they're very, you know, aggressively trying to get it open. Mm-hmm. So working through the process. Mm-hmm.
I did talk to the manager, and he assured me they're still coming. Okay. It is that hood, though, he said.
Yeah, someone said they saw some work in there, but...
Yeah, they have been working.
Okay. Okay. Anything else, please?
I have one thing. I was ill at our last meeting, but I did lie there on the couch and listen to the meeting. And I raised my hand in front of the TV, but nobody acknowledged my question from council.
I'm sorry, Mayor, I didn't see you at the time.
But I know there was talk about getting additional city flags. And my thought was that perhaps, I know the current flag has the old logo, so would the new ones have the new logo?
As adopted with the measures taken, it'll be the seal that will... as adopted as the official flag into the code.
Okay.
With tonight's second reading, I believe it was...
That was passed as an emergency.
Was it passed as an emergency? I think
other
you're right.
Other than the I think it's still an ordinance.
So in honor of Pat Felton.
That's good.
Okay.
Anything else, please? I have one item. I really want to thank Superintendent Denny Morrison for coming in and speaking to us this evening. Clearly, everyone in Xenia is aware of the tragic events of Tuesday. What I would just add to his comments, and he and I talked very briefly about this before the council meeting, in all of the bad that can be seen here, Denny also made it very clear that Xenians and the businesses and the community at large have demonstrated their resiliency, their compassion, and through any number of acts of charity and goodwill. I wanted to just highlight one or two of those to you, as I thought they were very significant. I think many of the surrounding school districts mm-hmm. sent flowers and other expressions of sympathy and compassion. I wish to thank them very sincerely for that. I'm sure Denny would echo that. But it came to my attention yesterday that a local business that would like to remain anonymous demonstrated clearly what Xenia is all about in terms of being a city of hospitality, recognizing that there was great stress on the staff and such, and the first responders and the counselors that were there at the school and taking care of the needs of people. They recognized that there was a great need to do something for them. This business happens to be a restaurant, called and volunteered and delivered a complete lunch to them today and asked for no recognition. I spoke with the manager this evening, promised I would not name them, but I would specifically call out that our businesses in this great city are acting in the truest sense of hospitality and compassion. And as the manager said to me, we're all Xenians. We just wanted to do this because it was the right thing. And I would suggest to all of council, all in the audience, and all who are listening, that this is what makes us a superb city to live in. So, thank you very much. Reports of city offices. Mr. City Manager, please.
Thank you, Mr. President, Council, and it's a robust agenda tonight, so I'll get right to it. First item is a request for authorization to enter into a contract with POD Design for an amount not to exceed $28,500 for park development services. Funding for these services was included in the original budget ordinance for fiscal year 2014. As detailed in our agenda report, our intention is to utilize these development services to help determine a plan, to help determine and plan out improvements for Shawnee Park, Saltwater Pits Park, and Sterling Green Park, with additional services to assist with other longer-range planning for Westside Park and Xenia Station. These parks were selected based on analysis from the Play Xenia initiative coordinated by the city planner this past summer, which involved diverse participation and feedback from community members and local organizations. Given this feedback, we're confident that targeting, planning, and ultimately new amenities for these parks will be well-received and supported by the public. As discussed in the five-year CIP work session earlier tonight, we are projecting and will recommend in the 2015 budget moving forward with improvements at these locations. Granting authorization this evening to enter into the contract will set in motion the process of making these needed and highly valued park enhancements.
Thank you very much. May I have a motion, please, to authorize the city manager to enter into the contract?
So moved.
Moved by the Vice President. Second, please.
Second.
Second by Councilwoman Mills. Any discussion or question on the motion, please?
Just one brief one.
Councilman.
Thank you very much. Just a comment. I'm assuming this is a similar process to what we did for Spring Hill Park.
Yeah, but probably not quite detailed in terms of public involvement and that. I'll let Brian speak to it. But
it will be similar. I'm in the process of setting up a series of five neighborhood meetings throughout the city, one in each kind of quadrant of the city, and we will use those meetings to inform the design of these parks as well as address some broader recreation and neighborhood issues. So it will be comparable. It's just that there's going to be some other issues being addressed at the same meeting, and the consultant will be actively engaged in those meetings.
Yeah, I know. I don't know how we try to get a little bit more better participation in those public meetings. I know.
Right.
When we did the Spring Hill Park, I was at most of the meetings, and it was like the same group of people all the time at all the meetings, but you would like to have had, you know, a few more participate.
I agree. That's always a challenge. We're going to try to send out, mail out notices and utility bills. I'm also reaching out to some local churches to help get the word out to the extent they're willing and able to do so. So I agree. We need to get the word out.
Perhaps televised on the website and channel as well.
Right. Press release.
Any other questions, comments, please? Seeing none, roll call.
Vice President Long.
Aye.
Councilman Kaup.
Aye.
Councilman Lauterbach.
Aye.
Councilman Smith.
Aye.
Councilwoman Mills.
Aye.
Mayor Bayless.
Aye.
President Engel.
Aye.
Motion carried.
Thank you.
For next item this evening, staff is recommending City Council waive the requirement to obtain competitive quotes for professional services and authorize a contract renewal with Enrollment Management Services in the amount of $60,000 commencing on November 1st, 2014 and ending on October 31st, 2015. Determining affordable ways of providing quality health insurance coverage for our employees continues to be one of our greatest organizational challenges. At the recommendation of staff a year ago, City Council employed the services of EMS to assist us in developing and implementing an opt-out program and to provide one-on-one consultative services to our employees to help them in determining the best and most cost-effective health insurance solutions for them individually. The services provided by EMS have been well received by city employees. The net result of the efforts of EMS, the insurance committee, and city staff is that we are well positioned to hold health insurance costs at or near current rates for the forthcoming program year. These programs have worked as designed to maximize coverage options available to us, limit cost, and to provide high quality benefits and reliable service to our employees. Staff request a motion this evening allowing us to continue our relationship with EMS. Excuse me.
Thank you very much. May I have a motion, please, to waive the requirement for competitive quotes?
So moved.
Moved by Councilwoman Mills. Second, please.
Second.
Second by the mayor. Any discussion or question on the motion, please? Mr. Vice President.
Why would we waive it? I mean, I know this is relatively new to the industry, but I don't know what does it hurt us to get competitive quotes on this?
I think for two reasons. One, because we're not aware of really similar services that are out there in terms of the scope of services. The service that is being provided is a little bit unique in that it's not just consultation relative to the insurance, but also either they are certified in terms of providing administration of Medicaid and so forth. The second reason is the timeline. Their contract runs currently through the end of this month. We have such a tight timeline this time of year in terms of when we get information back on renewal and the turnaround process through the open enrollment, which will occur in November. I would suggest that's certainly something we can look at moving into the future, but it is a process we would have to begin in late summer next year in order to accommodate, you know, the time frame that would be involved in some type of qualifications-based process.
Thank you. Councilman Kalb.
You had something else?
Yeah. I have a lot of reservation. I like what we did this first year, and we can make a big splash because we moved some things around. I don't predict we're going to see that this coming year because our employment level's not changed. I know situations change and we might see some ups and downs, but to pay this fee every year, I just think that we're going to eat up the savings eventually.
Well, what this will do, in reminder of the scope of the services they provide, they work throughout the course of the year, so any changes that we have in terms of qualifying events for employees, spouses for, you know, for their employers, they would help manage that with our opt-out program. Any new employees, they're helping to manage that process and providing the same services they would for existing employees. So we do see that incremental process all year long. What they will do is they will make appointments with employees again this year to go over their individual options. So they'll be busy again for the next month like they were last year in terms of managing those individual options with employees. Of course, anybody who currently has an opt-out will have to review any changes to, you know, the spouse's insurance that will occur as part of their current open enrollment process. So I would concur. It's a lot of money. It is less than it was with the original contract. We were able to negotiate it down a little bit. I think the proof is in the pudding in terms of what we anticipate our new program year cost to be. And I would suggest to you, we'll probably never be able to calculate what the actual savings are, simply because we are removing so much of the claims burden from, you know, from our experience. We'll never be able to truly calculate what the savings of premium will be.
So just one more comment, I'll turn to Councilman Cobb's question. So my point is that there's 82 people participated this year. Highly unlikely that their situations have changed in a year that 82 people are going to participate this year. I mean, their situation's not changed. So they may choose not even to revisit, I forget the gentleman's name. I know his first name.
Ralph.
So it seems like a whole lot of work up front in the first couple months that you're going to have and then nothing. So. I'm just hesitant. I want to see where we go with this. I'm not saying I want to hold this up, but I'm concerned at $67,000 a year that we're going to be eating up the premium savings if we continue to have to pay him this fee ongoing year after year for a service that it's less and less to manage. So, thank you.
Councilman Kalb.
Thank you very much. I did meet with the city manager this afternoon about this. Myself have some of the same concerns Councilman Long has. As far as the lateness of us getting this, that's not our fault. I mean, if this needed to go out for competitive bids, which I agree it should have went out for competitive bids, I mean, there's many, many qualified health brokers out there that if you understand health insurance, you can sit down with an employee and determine what the best option for that employee is given three options. There are many people certified in Medicare. So, you know, Ralph is not the only gentleman that can take three medical plans and determine what the best option is for an employee. And for $60,000, I work with health brokers every single day, and the ones I've talked to, I mean, they would love to do this job for $60,000. We pay our current health broker $24,000 in commission to take care of the city of Xenia's healthcare account. So we're paying this gentleman almost three times the amount that we pay our health broker for the health insurance. And I agree with Councilman Long. I mean, the database has already been collected now. I believe we own the database, correct? I mean, like if we would quit using Ralph's services, we have, that's our information.
We don't. We have the final report that shows us what the opt-out amounts are, but we do not have all of the data that went into the data.
I thought the original contract stated that we that was our information.
His formula, his spreadsheet is proprietary information. What we get is essentially the final report out of that, because we don't want access to any of the individually identifying information. So we're getting the back end of that information, the actual spreadsheet, that format, that process is proprietary for, in terms of their company.
Yeah. Well, I agree. I mean, you know, I do not disagree. When you eliminate high claims individuals off of your healthcare, of course you're going to lower your annual premium renewal, obviously. We've succeeded in doing that. I see this being a very easy process this year, now that we've gotten all these people off and we're still paying him $60,000. Last year we ended up a net savings of $5,000. And then that net savings, that doesn't even count the hours upon hours upon hours of administrative time that we spent on this program. So we ended up in the hole in this program last year.
Well, I would respectfully disagree, because we did have cash savings with the program. The staff is utterly incapable of providing this service. This is an additional benefit that we provide to our employees. And we have employees across the board who have benefited from this program. They benefited because they have a more reliable service in terms of healthcare coverage. They benefit because many of them are saving money. In a time when we can't provide the types of wage increases that we would like to do, the opportunity to save them money, I think, is a win-win. The program, while there are a lot of people out there who can provide Medicaid consultative services or who can provide brokerage services, what we get in this arrangement is a unique combination of a number of skills. And I can tell you, in my 8 years with the city, I've never seen a firm that provides this group of skills together and that can provide the overall overarching range of services that are demanded in a time frame that is as tight as what we have. And that's not within our control. When we look at an open enrollment process that starts November 1, we don't get renewal rates until usually September, late September at that. So we've got about a 30 to 45 day window to negotiate what the options are, to look at it, to come back to council, to get it approved, and then begin an open enrollment process. From that open enrollment process in November to December, when we have to have everything committed, we've got, again, a narrow window. So you have a very, very tight timeline to see a very complicated process that, I might add, with the Affordable Care Act, is getting exponentially worse. It, with the new requirements, I was just talking to the assistant finance director today, the new requirements on what we have to do to track things, to monitor, it is utterly absurd. Will end up costing us even more money to put systems in place to monitor that. So this is an extraordinarily complicated process with significant financial implications. I know this is a lot of money. I agree it is. I'm not necessarily comfortable with the amount. We were able to bring the total cost down a little bit. But with what we're projecting right now, and again, we'll be coming back at the next council meeting with a recommendation from the insurance committee in terms of a program for next year. But what initially looks like, you know, at minimum, a 3.5% savings if we were to stay with our current provider, in a time where most agencies, public or private out there, are seeing 10 to 20 or more percent premium increases on their renewals, I think the process has been a phenomenal success. And as I said, we'll never know how much money we save here, but I guarantee you it's a solid six figures, a solid six figures.
Other comments, please. Mr. Vice President.
I just want to clarify, my reservation is not to the merit of the saving we produce this year. It's the ongoing cost of EMS and what they have into this going forward. It's my concern, but thank you.
My question. This is $60,000 this year. What was it last year?
70.
So he did lower a little bit. Because I remember before we voted on that, we were like, that's a lot of money. And he said, well, we'll review that. So it did come down some.
Yeah, my other reservation, I know Councilman Smith, Councilman Lauterbach, Long, and myself all made comment about the opt-out fee being seeming considerably high. And even yourself as the city manager agreed that perhaps it was high. And he's going to be starting this process, and we don't even know. I mean, shouldn't those opt-out fees come back to council here for our approval on this is what we're willing to give an employee? We paid a city employee last year $19,000 not to take health insurance. And that's documented. $19,000 not to take health insurance. So, I mean, you know, some of these people are now getting money for not taking health insurance that never took health insurance in the past anyways.
Well, I think a couple points to that point. We have to provide that opportunity to everyone, because if not, we would be discriminating against individuals who have certain health conditions, and we'd be filed with a lawsuit. To the second point, with that particular family that had a $19,000 payout, had they taken family insurance, we would have paid out of between $14,000 and $15,000 for that benefit. Plus, we would have had the total cost of what is a substantially high claimant on our claims, which would have had undoubtedly an impact on our renewal. And then the third point, I agree, we shouldn't be moving forward with any discussions with employees in terms of what that program will look like moving forward. That's why we'll be coming back at the next council meeting with recommendations on what the program is or should be for next year for council's approval. Work in earnest with employees through the process won't begin until after that point. Around November 1st is when the contract stipulates that process has to begin, and it needs to be done by December 3rd, because that's a requirement through whatever insurance arrangement that we'll end up with, because they have to have time to set that the infrastructure on their end in place before a January 1 start date.
Other comments, questions, please?
We also have a two-year contract with our health broker, and I mean, we eliminated over half of the people on our health insurance. I mean, it's my expectation, you know, typically you're paid by the size of the account. A lot of carriers pay per member, per head, per month. You know, I would expect that $24,000 to be $12,000 next year, because the size of the group is literally half of what it was. Now, I understand the workload's the same, but that's the way it is in the industry. I mean, you get paid by the number of heads.
I think our approach should be, you know, in large part on the merit of the service. You know, they brought this service to us. It's resulting in substantial savings, and I would hate to reward them with a substantial reduction in, you know, and what is a pretty, right now, a pretty good rate compared, you know, by comparison to what other communities are paying for a similar service.
Other comments? Seeing none. Roll call, please.
Vice President Long.
Yes.
Councilman Kaup.
No.
Councilman Lauterbach.
Aye.
Councilman Smith.
Aye.
Councilwoman Mills.
Aye.
Mayor Bayless.
Aye.
President Engel.
Aye.
Motion carried.
Thank you.
Next this evening is a request for authorization to execute an amendment number 2 of the Business Support Services Agreement with Med 3000, also known to us and staff as McKesson, for a 3-year term with a reduced billing fee of 5.5%. As described in your agenda report, staff members from the Fire Division and Finance Department have worked closely with Med 3000 to eliminate reporting errors and correct other problems that have had negative impacts on our emergency medical service billing. In addition, and because of the new efficiencies created in our reporting system, we were able to negotiate a reduction in the billing fee from 6.5% to 5.5%. Staff respectfully request authorization to execute the amendment, allowing the new arrangement to take effect.
Thank you very much. May I have a motion to authorize the city manager to execute, please?
So moved, Mr. President.
Moved by Councilman Lauterbach. Second, please.
Second.
Second by Councilman Smith. Any discussion or question on this motion, please? Seeing none, roll call.
Vice President Long.
Aye.
Councilman Kaup.
Aye.
Councilman Lauterbach.
Aye.
Councilman Smith.
Aye.
Councilwoman Mills.
Aye.
Mayor Bayless.
Aye.
President Engel.
Aye.
Motion carried.
Thank you.
The next item, staff is requesting a motion to award the filter media replacement project at the water treatment plant to FEMCO Services and to authorize execution of a contract in an amount not to exceed $42,314. On September 23rd, bids were open for the filter media replacement project, and FEMCO was the lowest bid. Staff has conducted a reference check of the company and found them to be of good repute. We respectfully request a motion to award the bid and authorize authorization to sign the contract.
Thank you. May I have a motion to award the bid, please?
So moved, Mr. President.
Moved by Councilman Lauterbach. Second, please.
Second.
Second by Councilwoman Mills. Any discussion or question on this motion, please? Seeing none, roll call.
Vice President Long.
Aye.
Councilman Kaup.
Aye.
Councilman Lauterbach.
Aye.
Councilman Smith.
Aye.
Councilwoman Mills.
Aye.
Mayor Bayless.
Aye.
President Engel.
Aye.
Motion carried.
Thank you.
The next item is requested this evening that Council introduce a resolution approving the amended solid waste management plan of the Greene County Solid Waste Management District. After a very long process, which saw considerable public engagement, The amended plan must now be brought before the respective legislative authorities for local jurisdictions in Greene County. If approved by municipalities equaling more than 75% of the county's population, and with the approval of the Greene County Commission, and upon final acceptance by the Ohio EPA, the amended plan will be considered officially adopted. Most of the changes originally recommended that created concern locally have been altered or eliminated, including the changes to the yard waste recycling center. Overall, changes, in my opinion, are positive and represent benefits to the Xenia community. Having been directly involved in the review process of the amended plan, I endorse the plan and recommend City Council formally approve as well.
Thank you. May I have an introduction, please?
So introduced, Mr. President.
Introduced by Councilman Kalp. Thank you.
Moving along, next item this evening is a recommendation to approve as an emergency an ordinance authorizing entrance into a First Amendment to option and lease agreement with Red Spires Asset Sub LLC, an entity of American Tower, to use a portion of 966 Tower Road to operate a wireless telecommunications facility. In essence, this action is providing for an upfront payment for of a long-term lease for the site of the existing wireless tower adjacent to the service center on Tower Road. After extensive analysis by the City Manager's Office, Finance, and Law Departments, the terms and conditions of the proposed agreement are deemed appropriate and a good value to the city.
Thank you very much. May I have a motion, please, as an emergency?
So moved.
Moved by the Vice President. Second, please.
Second, Mr. President.
Second by Councilman Lauterbach. Any discussion or question on this motion, please? Councilman.
Just for clarification, so they're giving us $40,000 up front and then the lease payments.
In lieu of a long-term series of lease payments. And we did the calculations out looking at net present value.
Yeah, there were two different alternatives, and, you know, it depends on what the future is going to hold. I would think maybe the other alternative might be better in the long run, given certain conditions. However, with the $40,000 upfront payment, flip a coin.
And so. the other point, with the changes in wireless telecommunications and industry, right, look over the duration of this, who knows what's even applicable in 20 years.
Any other questions, please? Seeing none, roll call.
Vice President Long.
Aye.
Councilman Kalp.
Aye.
Councilman Lauterbach.
Aye.
Councilman Smith.
Aye.
Councilwoman Mills.
Aye.
Mayor Bayless.
Aye.
President Engel.
Aye.
Motion carried.
Thank you.
Without further ado, to Councilman Lauterbach's point, as previously discussed with City Council, staff is recommending this evening adoption of an emergency resolution supporting the proposed U.S. 35 expansion project, which would extend as a limited access facility a portion of U.S. 35 from just west of the city of Xenia to the city of Beaver Creek. Implementation of this project provides substantial benefits to the entire Greene County community and specifically to the city of Xenia by improving access for goods and services to and from the city and our local businesses. The project further benefits local populations by improving safety through the elimination of congested intersections and cross-traffic turns and reduces vehicular emissions through less congestion and reduced vehicle idling. The measure is presented as a joint resolution in conjunction with Greene County Commission, Beaver Creek Township, and the city of Beaver Creek.
Thank you very much. May I have a motion, please, as an emergency?
So moved as an emergency, Mr. President.
Moved by Councilman Lauterbach. Second, please.
Second.
Second by Councilman Kalp. Any discussion or question on this motion, please?
MVRP would be very happy. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Any other discussion or question, please? Seeing none, roll call, please.
Vice President Long.
Aye.
Councilman Kalp.
Aye.
Councilman Lauterbach.
Aye.
Councilman Smith.
Aye.
Councilwoman Mills.
Aye.
Mayor Bayless.
Aye.
President Engel.
Aye.
Motion carried.
Thank you.
Just a couple of other items to update or reminders tonight. First is a reminder that we do have a joint session scheduled with the Xenia Community Schools for October 21st at 7 p.m. The superintendent and I met today, and Mr. President, we're getting with you to confirm that agenda. We anticipate it'll be a fairly brief agenda and follow up, just updating on a number of the initiatives. Specifically, I know that Councilwoman Mills and Dr. Washington have been working on their particular item, and a couple of other updates that night. To the point of the Pledge of Allegiance, my daughter actually will be leading the group in the pledge that night, and we will try to continue that tradition moving forward as well.
Great. Thank you.
We'll as a meet reminder at the
to,
board.
I'm sorry?
We meet at the
board. It will be at the board's administrative facility, yes. And we decided to do that in lieu of here just because they had more space for that size of the group. Another reminder that city offices will be closed to regular business on Monday, October 13th, which is Columbus Day. Many other federal and state agencies will be closed. Staff will be reporting as planned, and we'll have an in-house training that day. If you recall, we mentioned that'll be the ALICE training that we'll be doing here with our staff.
Mm-hmm.
I'd like to make a request.
Yeah.
Was there a question?
Yeah, you're right.
Okay.
The mayor was trying to move Columbus Day.
If you could just remind my wife of that, I would appreciate it. Would like to make a request, if it's amenable to council, to move back our quarterly ED report to November 13th. We've got a pretty robust agenda on the October 23rd meeting. So my recommendation, my request would be, if it's all right, we'll move that back to that first meeting in November. Are there any concerns?
Any concerns?
Not with me.
Okay. Thank you.
At great risk, I bring this next item up. Beggar's Night is scheduled for October 31st. It is my intention at this point to keep that date set. And I've had a number of calls, including some from the school district. We recognize there is a home football game. It's senior night, and I apologize that that conflict exists. We are trying to be consistent with most of the rest of the communities in the region, holding the actual Beggar's Night on Halloween from 6 to 8. We would only cancel if there's an imminent danger because of weather, and we would broadcast that publicly. But again, October 31st, we apologize for any inconveniences for families who have conflicts, but that is the date. And just finally tonight, I don't want to belabor a difficult subject, but I was at an event at Central State University this week when I began to get news as city manager. About the tragedy that the superintendent spoke of, and have a daughter there in sixth grade. It's been a tough week, and there's no good way to talk to your kids about this kind of stuff. So, just very proud to live in a community that shows so much support, and a school district with just outstanding staff, and proud of our fire and police for everything they did. So, apologize, but just it's inspiring to, in the light of such tragedy, to have such great people around.
Thank you very much. Anything for the city manager this evening, please? Seeing none, Mr. Finance Director.
Thank you, Mr. President. One item this evening, but before that, I'd like to make a clarification. We talked earlier about the flag, and I believe that legislation, both the fee and the legislation on the flag, is up for the second reading tonight. And I think what I was talking about earlier was the banner program, I think, was passed as an emergency at the last council meeting. Also, with regard to the property issue that was discussed earlier, I'm not sure, and I'll defer to the law director, but there's an item as a second reading. Is that a separate issue?
That's a separate issue. We've got three of them coming up.
Okay. Okay.
Yeah, it's a different piece of property.
Okay. With that, just the scheduled bills in the amount of $719,005.35.
May I have a motion, please, to pay our bills this evening?
So moved, Mr. President.
Moved by Councilman Lauterbach. Second, please.
Second.
Second by Councilwoman Mills. Any discussion or question on the bills, please? Seeing none, roll call.
Vice President Long.
Aye.
Councilman Cowp.
Aye.
Councilman Lauterbach.
Aye.
Councilman Smith.
Aye.
Councilwoman Mills.
Aye.
Mayor Bayless.
Aye.
President Engel.
Aye.
Motion carried.
Thank you. Anything for the Finance Director this evening, please? Seeing none, Mr. Law Director, you have a full slate as well.
We do. Thank you, Mr. President. We have a number of second readings this evening. First is the ordinance amending Part 2, Administrative Code, Title 2, General Provisions, Chapter 2 of 4, Official Standards in Title 12, Fees, Chapter 298, Fee Schedule of the Codified Ordinances, City of Xenia. This was originally introduced by Councilwoman Mills.
So moved.
Move for passage. May I have a second, please?
Second.
Second by Councilman Lauterbach. Discussion or question on this motion, please? Seeing none, roll call.
Vice President Long.
Aye.
Councilman Cowp.
Aye.
Councilman Lauterbach.
Aye.
Councilman Smith.
Aye.
Councilwoman Mills.
Aye.
Mayor Bayless.
Aye.
President Engel.
Aye.
Motion carried.
Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. President. Next, we have an ordinance amending Part 2, Administrative Code, Title 6, Administrative Chapter 236, Department of Finance, creating the Information Technology Fund and the Police and Fire Capital Improvement Fund, originally introduced by Vice President Long.
So moved.
Move for passage. Second, please.
Second.
Second by Councilman Smith. Any discussion or question on this motion, please? Seeing none, roll call, please.
Vice President Long.
Aye.
Councilman Cowp.
Aye.
Councilman Lauterbach.
Aye.
Councilman Smith.
Aye.
Councilwoman Mills.
Aye.
Mayor Bayless.
Aye.
President Engel.
Aye.
Motion carried.
Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. President. Next, we have an ordinance amending Part 2, Administrative Code, Title 6, Administration Chapter 260, Employees Generally, introduced by Councilman Lauterbach.
So moved.
Move for passage. Second, please.
Second.
Seconded by the mayor. Any discussion or question on this motion, please? I thought you had almost read employees generally recommended by originally introduced by Councilman Lauterbach. And I thought, which employees are those?
Just the special ones.
Roll call, please.
Vice President Long.
Aye.
Councilman Cowell.
Aye.
Councilman Lauterbach.
Aye.
Councilman Smith.
Aye.
Councilwoman Mills.
Aye.
Mayor Bayless.
Aye.
President Engel.
Aye.
Motion carries.
Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. President. Next, we have a resolution establishing a maximum amount for which a blanket purchase order may be issued, originally introduced by Vice President Long.
So moved.
Move for passage. Second, please.
Second.
Second by Councilman Smith. Any discussion or question on this motion?
What was that amount again?
On the
purchase order?
Purchase order, I think it was $1 million.
Right.
I remember. That's because we have utilities and DPL bills that are significant there.
Any other questions, please? Seeing none, roll call.
Vice President Long.
Aye.
Councilman Kaup.
Aye.
Councilman Lauterbach.
Aye.
Councilman Smith.
Aye.
Councilwoman Mills.
Aye.
Mayor Bayless.
Aye.
President Engel.
Aye.
Motion carried.
Thank you, Mr. President. Next, we have an ordinance amending Part 2 Administrative Code Title 6, Administration, Chapter 236, Department of Finance, originally introduced by Councilman Smith.
So introduced, Mr. President.
Move for passage. Second, please.
Second.
Second by Councilwoman Mills. Any discussion or question on this motion, please? Seeing none, roll call.
Vice President Long.
Aye.
Councilman Kaup.
Aye.
Councilman Lauterbach.
Aye.
Councilman Smith.
Aye.
Councilwoman Mills.
Aye.
Mayor Bayless.
Aye.
President Engel.
Aye.
Motion carried.
Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. President. Next, we have an ordinance amending Part 10, Streets, Utilities, and Public Services Code, Title 4, Utilities, Chapter 1040, Utility Billing, originally introduced by Councilman Smith.
So introduced, Mr. President.
Move for passage. Second, please.
Second.
Second by Councilman Kaup. Any discussion or question on this motion? Seeing none, roll call.
Vice President Long.
Aye.
Councilman Kaup.
Aye.
Councilman Lauterbach.
Aye.
Councilman Smith.
Aye.
Councilwoman Mills.
Aye.
Mayor Bayless.
Aye.
President Engel.
Aye.
Motion carried.
Thank you.
Thank you. Finally, Mr. President, we have an ordinance authorizing the transfer of property. I'm not going to read off the stats number. Originated by Councilman Kaup.
So moved, Mr. President.
Move for passage. Second, please.
Second.
Second by Councilwoman Mills. Any discussion or question on this motion, please? Seeing none, roll call.
Vice President Long.
Aye.
Councilman Kaup.
Aye.
Councilman Lauterbach.
Aye.
Councilman Smith.
Aye.
Councilwoman Mills.
Aye.
Mayor Bayless.
Aye.
President Engel.
Aye.
Motion carried.
Thank you, Mr. President. Nothing further this evening.
Thank you. Anything for the Law Director's Office, please? Seeing none, any updates to our summary of action items, Mr. City Manager?
Again, we noted we'll move the economic development quarterly update to the first meeting in November, which I believe is the 13th. I think we've covered the healthcare portion. Community funding guidelines will come back the first meeting in November. And then exploration of the tax abatements, we have a meeting this week with the developer. We'll be exploring some incentivization options.
Thank you very much. Any additions from my colleagues? Seeing none, reading of communications and discussion, Councilwoman Mills.
Thank you. I have a lot of great things to invite you to come in our community. First off is the annual Circle of Victory Cancer Awareness 5K Walk. It's going to be held Sunday, October the 16th at Green Memorial Hospital. Registrations begins at 12:30 and the walk begins at 2 o'clock. Please join the walkers as we fight cancer in Greene County one step at a time. So please, if you are able to, come and join that. Next is come and hear the stories of Jim Pee Wee Martin. He is a World War II paratrooper of the 506 PIR of the 101st Airborne. He will be at Xenia High School's auditorium on Monday, October the 13th at 7 p.m. He's going to have great stories and we can honor his service. So if you're interested in history, come and join us on that. Next is the ladies Fashion Swappin' Shop is going to be held Saturday, October the 18th from 11 o'clock to 2 o'clock at the Greene County Career Center. This event is so much fun. Ladies, you grab five things that you don't use anymore. Purses, earrings, jewelry, dresses, boots, shoes, whatever it is, and you bring them with you to this event. You will turn them in and you'll get five tickets. Throughout the day, you're going to enjoy a lunch by Current Cuisine from Yellow Springs, be able to shop at 20 different vendors such as Damsels in Defense, Tupperware, Pink Zebra, etc. And then after that, there's many basket raffles and entertainment. And at the end of the day, you take your five tickets and you line up, and they have everything that was brought in out on display, sized and shown. And they say, get on your mark, get set, and go. And it's grab what you can, and you get your five items, something different that you get to take home, and that's the swap. So it is a great opportunity. It supports the Green Community Health Foundation. So you're supporting our community once again. And tomorrow is the deadline, but I'm sure if you call Lori Fox, she will be able to get you in. But it is a wonderful opportunity to have some fun and to enjoy.
Are we going to have police there?
Oh, I don't know. It will be the sheriff's department on this one.
Have you ever been to Macy's or Beerman's the day after Thanksgiving?
Yes, sir.
I was wondering if it was training for Black Friday.
I've stood in line and did the swap, yes. I have been. But it is a wonderful activity, so if you're able to do. And after that, take your sweetheart on a carriage ride. That same Saturday from 4 p.m. to 8 p.m. at night is the Sweetest Day Carriage Rides. And if you will arrive at Green County Historical Society, where participants waiting for their carriage will be showered with such items as chocolate, flowers, musical entertainment, and other mementos of this special evening. Plan to devote about an hour for this event, including the mingling, entertainment, and approximately 20-minute carriage ride. You must pre-register for that. And you can pre-register with the Downtown Xenia Now organization. And also on that day, if you are not into swapping clothes or going on carriage rides, go take a walk. And the walk is going to be a Tales of the Trees, and it is a guided walk through Woodland Cemetery beginning at 1:30. It's a combining tales of the past with the trees of the present, and this will be the first historic walk by the City of Xenia Tree Committee. Participants should meet at the Stone Cottage located at the main drive when entering the cemetery. So it will be a wonderful afternoon of being able to go out and see one of the neat things. Catherine Wilson from the Historical Society will also be there, along with people from the from the Tree Committee, to be able to answer all questions. So I encourage you to do that. Another thing that the Tree Committee is doing is having a first ever Tree Committee Fall Foliage Photo Contest. And the photos must be of trees within the City of Xenia limits. And sorry, Wes, you can't do it. And it has to be by people who are not professional photographers.
Okay.
But we are asking that they be digitally taken and submitted that way. So go onto our website and there will be more information. And the photos must be taken from September 1st through October 31st. So you still have time to get in on that. Trick or treat, as our city manager has spoke about, of the time and date. There's also going to be several businesses to agree to stay open and hand out candy in downtown Xenia. So we would like to ask you to come downtown and support these businesses. And the children will get a passport, a pumpkin passport. And as they trick-or-treat, they will get block stamped, and when they're done, their passport can be redeemed for prizes. There'll be free hot chocolate and popcorn, and so it's another opportunity. If you want more information, please go to xeniadowntownnow.org or the DXN Facebook page. You know, recently in our community, we have had an overwhelming sadness covering us. Every day the sun comes up, and we move through our daily routines, but many of us carry a heavy heart. This week, a precious life was lost at Central Middle School, and I do give my condolences to the family, friends, students, and staff members of Central Middle School. Many of us are trying to process this event and other events that have strong emotional ties. If you ever need someone to share your feelings with, please reach out. Reach out to local churches, a trusted friend, or loved ones. There's also many numbers in the phone book for hotline and crisis. So please, you know, remember that there's people out in this world that do care, and that there is always, always, always someone there. You know, in this world, we only have each other. And I want to say kindness, generosity, forgiveness, and love can change lives. Thank you.
Thank you. Councilman Cap.
Thank you very much. I'd like to give prayers to the family. I too have twins that go to Central, so tragic. I had one other thing, and it slipped my mind, so.
We'll let you come back to it. Councilman Lauterbach.
Thank you, Mr. President. I, too, it's been heavy on my heart ever since I learned about the child. You know, it makes seeing life, our worries, everyday worries we worry about, so insignificant, so minute. I would just like to say, any child watching, if you're kindergarten to senior in high school, you might not hear this from a grief counselor, you might not hear this from your school counselor, but I want to tell you one thing, and remember three words I want you to remember tonight. Jesus loves you. He loves you with all of his heart, and there's going to be your friends going to turn their back on you. Sometimes you think your parents are going to turn their back on you, your grandparents, but Jesus never will. So, just if you would, always remember that. And parents, tonight, I've got a son that's 46 years old. I wish he was home so I could hug him. But hug your kids tonight and tell them you love them. And I mean, we've got to reach out to these kids. And please, if I can help in any way, anybody can call me 24 hours a day. I'm just heartbroken. And just remember that Jesus loves you. Thank you.
Thank you. Amen. Councilman Smith.
Thank you, Mr. President. Again, I'd like to thank Denny Morrison for being here. I run into him at the schools all the time. He is the face of the community schools. And what a wonderful person he is. In the morning, 7 o'clock, he's greeting students coming in. He starts his day early and it ends late. I'll see him at soccer games, at football games. He was at the homecoming dance Saturday night, just talking to the kids, getting to know them. And then Monday night, he's again at the soccer game for parents' night. I mean, he's just there all the time. And we just have a great group of kids in Xenia. Homecoming, congratulations to the Bucks for winning. Just lift the staff up at Central Middle School and really all teachers in general. It's just a tough job, and they have to deal with so much more other than reading and writing. And I'm just thankful that this is a wonderful community that does care. And that's all I have. Oh, remind people, I know there's early voting, I think, going on now. So get out and support the library, because that little levy they got is just pennies on a month for your home. And the library in Greene County is really used extensively by all types of people. So consider that. I don't want to tell you how to vote, but it's an investment in your community. Thank you.
Thank you. Mayor.
Thank you. I attended and brought greetings from Xenia for the international flag-raising event at Central State University. This was the first that they've ever had, and about 8 countries were represented, and the students actually from the different countries brought the flags out, raised them, and then they are permanently in the place by the administrative building. So it was a wonderful event. Other elected officials were in attendance from state and local government. Also, I just want to comment on the joint service that we had with Faith, your two churches, Faith United and our church, United AME, when we had worship in the park, and that was 2 weeks?
Sunday, 2 weeks ago.
2 weeks ago. 2 weeks Sunday. But it just was a wonderful, wonderful time, and where both congregations could come together, and we ate together afterwards, and it's just so refreshing to see that we can indeed live in the world together. And it works. Dr. Leah Gaston Fitchue, president of Payne Seminary, who is also an ordained minister, was a speaker and wonderful. Just did an excellent, excellent job. Wonderful. So it was a wonderful day, and both congregations are looking forward to doing something in the near future. As president of the Dayton Region Mayors and Managers, I attended the Wright-Patterson Partnership Update, and that's always very interesting. They're doing so much more with trying to get these partnerships started to share some responsibilities with different communities. For instance, like salt, we would share in the cost of salt for the street. They're opening the golf courses up. They're going to be open to the public, but they're proceeding very slowly because they want to be certain they don't take away from any of the other golf courses in the area. And their pool was open this summer to the public. So that was a good update. And then congratulations to Middle Run Baptist Church again on their 192nd anniversary this past weekend. It is the oldest Baptist church in Ohio. And then in addition, I found out it is one of the oldest in the country. So we congratulate them. This week I spoke to a Wilberforce University class, and then right after they had a convocation, so they asked me to follow them there. So I did go there and ended up, they called me up front to just give comments. So I brought greetings to them from Xenia, and I welcomed the new president. And once settled, the president, her name's Dr. Algenia Freeman, and she will attend one of our meetings and just introduce herself. And she is residing in Xenia. She asked me to help her find a place, and of course, the only place would be in Xenia. So she
I
is.
I know a good realtor.
Yeah.
He said Tony McElvain.
And then I was invited again to Central State for the designation of the 1890 land grant institution, and the city manager went, as well as our Mary Crockett. And the U.S. Secretary of Agriculture, Mr. Tom Vilsack, was the speaker. And this was a great event, and it'll bring a lot of opportunities to Central State, but additionally, will give us a lot of opportunities really for partnering and businesses taking part. So it'll be a good thing for Xenia as well. And then there were several ribbon cuttings, udders at the Apple Country Farm on 42 South, Athletes in Action, and they have a new radio station, Strong Tower Christian Media has combined their offices and studios from Springfield and Miamisburg right here to the Xenia campus. And that's 93.7 and 100.7, both FM stations. And then McAfee Heating and Air, they've brought a new office here to Xenia, and they're at 30 Kinsey Road. And then since Tuesday, before I say that, I do want to talk about the beautification awards. I did issue those to the residents of Xenia, and that's always a thrill. I mean, it's such a blessing to knock on the door, and first they think you're there to sell something, then when they when they realize why you're there, you're their best friend. So, but some, when they open the door, they recognize me now, and they know why I'm there. But it was particularly interesting, and her name is Betty, and she lives on Moccasin, and she rents a house, and she completely redid the front yard, and the backyard is absolutely beautiful. But when you think about somebody renting a house, you certainly don't think about them planting beautiful flowers. She had all kinds of mums, and like I said, the backyard was just beautiful, and so it really lifts your spirits. They think I'm doing something for them and not realizing what they do for me, to just see how excited they are and how proud they are of their homes. And again, I just keep thanking them for what they do for Xenia, to make mm-hmm. Xenia look good for other people who come in. So yes. I do want to particularly highlight Betty, because she was so excited. I mean, she was at the door just... really, she said, I was hoping you would come. So I also reminded them that I don't select them, that there's a committee that goes around, and then anybody else can pick a home. So and then finally, lastly, since Tuesday, I have spent much of my time at Central Middle School, and no words can express the thanks and appreciation for the excellent job of the principal Deb Herman and the staff. You know, and one of the things that I know as a principal, since I'm a retired principal, it can be lonely because staff members have one another and everybody has one another, but the principal's kind of left out there alone. So I really wanted to be there, not only for the staff and the students, but for the principal as well, just to give them her support too. The superintendent has been there each day, as I said, to offer support and comfort. And then the central office staff and the Board of Education president have been there to help. Our police chief and officers have been there to assist. There is support from agencies, counselors, and psychologists within the school district and outside the school district. And then on Tuesday night when I was there, a group came from Cincinnati specializing in grief counseling for students. And then some of them returned the following morning so they could be a support as well. But everything that needed to be in place was in place for this particular time. Today, boxes and boxes of food were donated and delivered, and I'll be respectful, but I had in my report to say, because I didn't hear, I mean, he didn't tell me not to say, but I won't say the business, but a fairly new business, actually. Well, not, you know. Anyway, it was wonderful, and I mean, they had enough to feed everybody and who and had come some. In to help, yeah, and then some. And then, again, flowers have come from other school districts and businesses. I wish everyone could have just had a glimpse of what went on inside that building for those students and their children. It was just remarkable. Xenia citizens, you should be extremely proud to claim our schools and the Xenia community as your home. Please pray for Central Middle School and the parents dealing with this tragedy that their child will never forget. And please keep our own city manager and Councilman Kalp in your prayers, as they have children there too, as they talked about earlier. But they're doing as well as can be expected, and I was so happy to hear that for that particular child, it was a good day up until that period. And so it's nice to know that she was well-liked and there was no bullying, those kinds of things we always hear about. But we really ought to be thankful for what we have right here in Xenia. Thank you.
Thank you, Mayor. Mr. Vice President.
Thank you. I first want to show my support, too, for the libraries. If you get a chance to go out and vote for that levy, keep our public libraries well-funded and open to our communities. I, too, have a sixth grader who had questions, and it's always difficult to answer those questions for an 11-year-old who's, as all parents know, it's a very emotional time in their life. I'm switching to middle school, but oddly I found some comfort in something my grandmother read to me as a kid. It was Winnie the Pooh that said, "You are braver than you believe, you are stronger than you seem, and smarter than you think." And that's what I left my 11-year-old with. So, thank you.
Thank you very much. As for me, I would echo the sympathies and compassion expressed by all of our council members. Thank you, Councilman Ladderback, for that very sincere expression. I answer that amen. I believe in that with all my heart. Speaking to the city manager's opinion that he gave, I also support that. Please reach out to your children. Please talk with your children. They will have questions. They will need you as their leader, as their mentor, as their parent, to help them to understand something that is incomprehensible to us. You need to be there for them, support them, and if you need it, as was mentioned earlier, there are any number of resources available locally. Please, please, please reach out to those and take full advantage of them. Mr. City Manager, if we have any way of putting out some of those on our Facebook page and or television station in repeat, I would strongly suggest. Other than that, please, Xenia, take care of yourself. Please look out for yourselves and your neighbors. You never know when someone will be in need. Please always, I think forgiveness was mentioned earlier tonight, please reach out with that hand of forgiveness and that hand of understanding because you never know what impact you will make on someone's life just by reaching out. There's nothing else. I would ask for a motion to adjourn, please.
Second.
Moved and seconded. Roll call, please.
Vice President Long.
Aye.
Councilman Kaup.
Aye.
Councilman Lauterbach.
Aye.
Councilman Smith.
Aye.
Councilwoman Mills.
Aye.
Mayor Bayless.
Aye.
President Engel.
Aye.
Motion carried.
Thank you.